Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming for this three-minute thesis competition. We'll just start with a word of prayer. Lord, we commit this workshop into your hands, this competition. We pray that it will give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like to introduce our Master of Ceremonies today, Dr. Vishali, and she will handle the proceedings from now. She's a doctor from the Department of Biostatistics and Research. Thank you, Vishali.
Good morning. We'd just like to welcome every one of you here for this three-minute thesis presentation. Before we actually start, I would like to introduce the chief guest here. The chief guest for today's presentation is Dr. Joy. She's the head of the Department for Microbiology. We welcome you, ma'am. We would also like to welcome the three judges on panel today, Dr. A.M. Cherian. We're very fortunate to have you here, sir. Dr. L. Jaisalan and Dr. Abraham Padikail. So just a few words before we actually start about the three-minute presentation thesis is that I would like to give you a brief idea about how this actually was started here. So this is actually, it originated only in the University of Queensland, where the main idea was to see how the researchers are able to explain their research in very limited time. So and then this was adopted into many universities all over the world, and it happens yearly, it's going to be held every year from now onwards. So the three judging panel in our for the today's competition is going to be Dr. A.M. Cherian. Dr. A.M. Cherian is the founder of CEU, Clinical Epidemiology Unit in our institution. He was the former head of the department for the Department of Medicine, and he was also a professor right now in the Bangalore Baptist Hospital. Sir was the one who actually initiated a lot of Inclan projects into our institution here, and he was actually responsible who also brought into some from departments like endocrine, rheumatology. So, sir, we are very fortunate to have you here, sir. It's good to have you here, and we warmly welcome you, sir. Thanks for accepting our invitation. The next judge is Dr. L. Jaisalan. He was the former professor. He was the former head of the Department of Biostatistics, and he's also the founder of Biostatistics Research and Training Center. I'm sure most of you already know him because he's the one who deals with a lot of sample size and designing studies here. The third judge in the panel is Dr. Abraham Padikail, who is also the professor and head in the Obstetrics and Gynecology Department. Sirs, we all welcome you once again. Thank you for accepting our invitation to be the judges. So the rules and regulations for those who are presenting the thesis today is something like this. You will be asked to have only one single slide, PowerPoint slide, and you would not be allowed any kind of animations or any kind of transitions that you wanted to do in your slides. You will not have any additional electronic media like any audio or visual supports. There will be no additional props. You will have to have only one single slide where you will be presenting the entire thesis to the benefit of those audience who are not going to be expertise in your field. So the presentation limitation, as you already know, is 3 minutes, exactly 3 minutes. If anybody exceeds the allotted time, will actually be disqualified. Okay, and the most important thing is the final decision will be made by the three judges in the panel. Now, the judging criteria is going to be something on one of these criteria, where the first one is going to be the communication style, whether the thesis topic was communicated in the language that was understandable to those who are not familiar or not specialist in that field. then did the presentation help the audience understand the research is what is the most important thing, whether we are all able to understand what your objective is and what your findings are as a research. And even more important is, did it really make the audience want to know more, okay, about your research is something that is also important. So these are the three things which the judges are going to look to rate your presentations today. Then there will obviously be a short break. Now I hand over to Dr. Tambu for...
So we'll start with our presenters. They will have 3 minutes, and we have an already listed order, and we won't have questions till the end of the competition is over. So they will have 3 minutes, we'll have a 30 seconds handover for the next person, and then the next person will start. The timer will start the moment the person comes up here, and then they nod the head or make any gesture to start the presentation. So we'll start with the presentations. There will be 10 marks from each judge, a total of 30 marks. There are 3 judging criteria which have been given. So we have a timing system which the slide will be put up for 1 minute, and then the presenter will come. So I invite Dr. Prakash to come from Department of Biochemistry, and Dr. Prakash will start presenting in about 30 seconds. After Dr. Prakash, the next order of presentation is already known to the presenter, so the person next, I urge you to be in somewhere in the front so that when he finishes, then you have a minute between the next presentation to start.
Good morning, I am Dr. Prakash, Assistant Professor in the Department of Biochemistry. I did my MD from All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. My guide is Dr. Kalpana Luthra. It's been more than 3 decades since the discovery of human immunodeficiency virus, which has killed millions and infected several others. But till date, there has been no successful vaccine to this particular infection. Usually, vaccines are protective by inducing a type of antibodies known as neutralizing antibodies, which will prevent from the virus from infecting the human cells. In case of, so what are these neutralizing antibodies? These are the antibodies which prevent the virus from entering into the human cells. Now, such antibodies are in general produced naturally in infected individuals. Now, in most of the adult patients, it has been studied extensively that in natural infection, in a small percentage of people, these antibodies are produced, which can be protective against a number of different subtypes of viruses. Whereas, so far, there has been no study to analyze this particular phenomenon in children. Now, why did I want to study in children is because of 2 important reasons. One is that these are infected at the time when their immune system is still immature. And as a result, the infection is quite more rapidly progressive than in adults. So for that, what we did is, we recruited around 51 children, and we categorized them as those who are not receiving antiretroviral therapy and those who are receiving treatment with antiretroviral therapy drugs. And before we started to analyze whether they are producing neutralizing antibodies or not, we first did a general check whether the total antibody levels itself is different between these 2 groups of individuals. In that case, we saw that it is not. Both are equally same. And then we did a simple assay to analyze the presence of neutralizing antibodies. In that, we used a specialized cells in which if the virus enters into the cells, then the light will glow, which can be measured by a simple instrument. And if we add the plasma which will contain the neutralizing antibody along with the virus, and if they will not be allowed the virus to enter into the cell so that the light will not glow. So as a result, so with this simple experiment, we tested around 6 panel of viruses, and we found that at least 3 of them were producing good amount of neutralizing antibodies in these children. Excited by this finding, we further studied even 8 more viruses and analyzed the neutralizing antibodies, and we found that at least 30% of the plasma samples were able to neutralize more than 50% of the viruses we were able to test. So the implication of this is that we can use this to study the regions which are targeted by these antibodies, and those regions in the virus can be used as vaccine candidates. At the last, I would like to thank my guide, Dr. Kalpana Luthra, study participants and their families, and Indian Council of Medical Research for funding my research. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mayank.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Dr. Mayank Gupta from Department of Pathology. I'm working as assistant professor there in the department. And I did my MD from King George Medical College, Lucknow. And my thesis guide was Dr. Raj Mehrotra and Dr. Nusrat Hussain. So as we all know, squamous cell carcinoma is the most malignant, is the most common malignant neoplasm of the oral cavity. And metastasis in these tumors can occur either by lymphatic or hematogenous route. Formation of new blood vessels, that is angiogenesis, can occur, is responsible for the hematogenous spread in these tumors. VEGF has been implicated as one of the factors for angiogenesis, which aids in the dissemination of tumor cells from primary to a distant site. So in this particular study, we evaluated the expression of VEGF in 30 cases of squamous cell carcinoma of oral cavity, that is 10 cases of each grade, and compared it with 10 cases each of leukoplakia, that is pre-malignant, and pyogenic granuloma, that is non-malignant. The brown intracytoplasmic staining of VEGF was considered as positive and was counted in 500 tumor cells. And then on the basis of intensity and percentage positivity, VEGF score and the corresponding VEGF grade was calculated. So the VEGF score ranged from 0 to 1,500 and the corresponding VEGF grade ranged from grade 0 to grade 3. So in this particular study, we observed that the maximum expression of VEGF was seen in well-differentiated squamous cell carcinomas, as a result of which the mean VEGF score and the VEGF grade was highest in well-differentiated tumors. And as the differentiation declined, the expression of VEGF was reduced and the mean VEGF score was reduced and the corresponding VEGF grade also declined. Leukoplakia and pyogenic granuloma had significantly less score than well-differentiated tumors and moderately differentiated tumors, but the VEGF grade was similar to the poorly differentiated tumors. So how does vascular endothelial growth factor act on the receptors? How does it cause proliferation? So VEGF acts on the tyrosine kinase receptors present on the endothelial cell surface. And these receptors undergo dimerization and transphosphorylation, which results in the proliferation of the endothelial cells. So there's formation of the new blood vessels, that is angiogenesis. This mechanism remains active in well-differentiated tumors, but in poorly differentiated tumors, this mechanism becomes inactive, and there are other factors which are responsible for angiogenesis play a role in formation of the new blood vessels. So this particular study actually implies that.
The next person is Dr. Elizabeth Vinod.
Very good morning to everybody. I'm Elizabeth Vinod from the Department of Physiology. My guide is Dr. Satya Subramani. So as we know, the heart is a muscular organ about the size of a closed fist, which functions as the body's circulatory pump, which has the ability to contract and pump out blood, which is essential for life. So just like how this fan requires a source of current, there are specialized group of cells called the pacemaker cells, which are present on the heart, which is responsible for generating currents and therefore the rhythm. If you take a cardiac muscle cell, the membrane, that is a cardiomyocyte, it has a number of channels through which ions flow. This flow of ions is responsible for generating a current and therefore the rhythm. In my thesis of all the major channels, I chose the sodium-calcium exchanger, which works on the principle of the Barton system, which is nothing but, so you have a sodium-calcium exchange, as the name says. So you have normally calcium from inside the cell going to the outside of the cell, and then you have sodium from the outside of the cell going into the inside of the cell at the same time using the same exchanger but using specific sites. But this exchanger also has another speciality. It can be reversed to become calcium extrusive and sodium intrusive. Lanthanum is a trivalent alkali earth metal which has been used in numerous experiments as a substitute of calcium. So, if I were to replace calcium with lanthanum, it would go into the cell through the calcium port of the sodium-calcium exchanger. But we wanted to show otherwise. What if we created favorable situations for the lanthanum to go in through the sodium port of the sodium-calcium exchanger? But my experiment was really simple. All I did was take out the heart from the rat, mount it, perfuse it with a normal extracellular solution with the same composition of our blood. So with oxygen, I got it beating. Then I removed the sodium. So now, since there's no sodium outside, the sodium from inside had to go outside at the cost of calcium from outside entering inside. So what I ended up with was a cell which was full of calcium. It's like you ask for a little rain, but then you end up with a flash flood. So then you end up having a contracture. After this, I added lanthanum, and what I saw was a relaxation, which was to say that lanthanum had to go in through something to push out the calcium and therefore relaxation. So it took the sodium side of the sodium-calcium exchanger. So what? So what if lanthanum takes one of the sides or both of the sides, or so what even if it goes through the sodium-calcium exchanger? Just like how a mango is it to a fruit, the sodium-calcium exchanger is to the pacemaking mechanism of the heart. So, from this very simple experiment, I've got this tiny bit of information that I have a tiny molecule that can regulate this exchanger, which is known to play a huge role in pacemaking mechanism and which is the jump start to the heart and keeps it going. So that's exactly what I need to do. This experiment was my jump start and I need to keep going. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Anand. I'm from the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, and I completed my MD here in CMC Willow, and my thesis guide was Dr. Josh Therian, head of PMR. As healthcare professionals, we are nurtured in a culture that's obsessed with numbers. We are expected to treat blood pressures over 90 millimeters of mercury of diastolic pressures. We are expected to treat diabetes to a level to achieve less than 7 of HbA1c. We are expected to treat obesity to achieve a BMI of less than 25. We are expected to produce research papers to get a promotion. So our fascination with numbers is so huge that it spills over into our medical practice as well. One such issue with a number-based treatment was in terms of managing bladder in persons with spinal cord injury. As many of you would know, spinal cord injury is a condition which results in multiple impairments, which includes bladder impairment as well. So in practice, we are traditionally asked to treat people with bladder pressures over 40 centimeters of water, because 40 centimeters of water pressure can actually cause a back pressure in the kidneys and can end up in renal failure in the end. But the problem is, this 40 centimeter cutoff was based on findings from one study. And the more important problem was that one study was not done in spinal cord injury. It was done in a related group of people with a condition called spina bifida. So I wanted to know the truth of what's happening in spinal cord injury per se, rather than borrow a cutoff from a different population. So we replicated the study that was originally published in 1981 and found, to our surprise, that in our study, we found that less than 1% of people had significant kidney changes that needed any intervention, whereas the original study had stated that 45% of them needed surgical intervention. So we found that we have enough grounds to challenge the traditional treatment methods which say that we need to go by the numbers. We now have enough evidence to say that we'll give a personalized care. After all, we are all here to give personalized care to all our patients. Thank you.
Dr. Rekha.
Good morning. I'm Rekha from Department of Hematology, working under Dr. Eunice Sindhui. Do you know how much iron we require daily? We need 20 milligrams of iron, but we get only 1 milligram from our diet. The remaining iron is obtained from recycled RBCs. Human body cannot excrete excess iron. For this reason, iron metabolism is highly balanced. Disruption of this balance can either lead to iron deficiency anemia or iron overload. Both can adversely affect the quality of life. Iron deficiency anemia or IDA is highly prevalent in our country. It's a major public health concern. The causes are mainly attributed to poor socioeconomic status and other common factors. Can we really explain all IDA with these causes? The answer is no. There is a small percentage of patients where the cause could not be identified. Some people don't even respond to iron supplements. In pregnancy, the incidence of IDA is high and the iron supplementation is a common practice. However, the response to iron supplements is suboptimal in a subgroup of subjects. On the other end, primary iron overload or hemochromatosis is thought to be very rare in India and it is overlooked at many times. The molecular basis of this primary hemochromatosis is not clear. Secondary iron overload is a common feature in transfusion-dependent anemias and there is a disproportionate iron overload in these patients irrespective of their number of transfusions and chelation regimen. How can we explain it? So, my PhD thesis was to evaluate the role of genetic variants in determining iron status in patients with different iron-related disorders. To study this, we screened genetic variants and correlated with various iron parameters in four different cohorts. Interestingly, we have identified mutations which are responsible for inherited anemias such as iron refractory iron deficiency anemia and atransferemia. We also observed a strong association of genetic variants with lower iron stores in IDA. In pregnancy, our study clearly demonstrates the role of genetic variants in response to iron supplements, and this is a novel finding. DNA analysis reveal mutations causing hereditary hemochromatosis for the first time in India. In beta thalassemia, the genetic variant in an iron exporter gene was found to be associated with, it's one of the cause for disproportional iron overload in beta thalassemia. So my PhD work is the first comprehensive analysis showing the role of genetic variants in determining body iron status in different iron-related disorders. And my study findings were translated into proper diagnosis and better clinical management in these iron-related disorders. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Naveen from the Department of Physical Medicine and Rehab. I did my MD from SMS Medical College, Jaipur, under the guidance of the professor and head of the department, Dr. Mrinal Joshi. What would we all do? Say a group of elephants were running towards us. It's obvious we would run. What would happen? Our heart rate is going to increase. Our blood pressure is going to increase. We are going to sweat out of fear. The same thing you can note. Say I place two electrodes on the palm of your hand or your sole, and I see how much voltage is changing. I suddenly ask your mother or your loved one or your wife to just enter the room, you would notice that the response is there. You're not sweating, but there's a response. All these responses, say heart rate, blood pressure, sweating, control of body temperature, are under the control of the autonomic nervous system. India has the highest proportion of road traffic accidents every year, and trauma, not only road traffic accidents, it could be in any other form, can lead to spinal cord injury. It could be falling in a well, falling from the roof. So spinal cord injury, as we all know, not only a person cannot move his limbs, but he has difficulty in breathing, he has difficulty in control of the heart rate. What did we want to see? We just wanted to see how the autonomic functions are affected in spinal cord injury. So how is this important? Say you have to sit, you have to stand, you require good control of your blood pressure. Also, in individuals with spinal cord injury, it's been noted that they have sudden changes in blood pressure and heart rate, which can be life-threatening. So we did a study using measurements of heart rate and blood pressure. We gave stimuli such as placing ice on the palm and sole. We did electrical voltage recordings from the palm and sole. And we found that individuals with higher level of injuries, injury in the neck, injury in the upper part of the back, they are the ones who are more prone to these autonomic fluctuations. How is it important? And the more important thing is that many of them are asymptomatic. Say your BP is very high and you're not symptomatic, your life could be threatened. By finding the severity of autonomic dysfunction, we can actually educate our caregivers and the patients regarding the importance and that they are prone for such disturbances. Also, it's been seen that people with severe autonomic dysfunction are also less likely to recover from the neurological insult that they have sustained. In that regard, one is we educate them, we prevent complications, and also we can prognosticate. This is how my study can be of relevance in spinal cord injury. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Nitin.
Very good morning to all of you. I'm Dr. Nitin from the Department of Endocrine. I shall be presenting my thesis, which I've done under the guidance of Professor Thomas Paul. The title of my thesis is to study the manifestations of Wilson's disease with respect to endocrine. We all know Wilson's is a disease of copper metabolism, predominantly affecting the liver and the brain. But I'm sure many of you on the floor would be thinking, why of all I had to choose Wilson, such a rare disease, for my thesis, and that too being from an endocrine background. Well, there are more than one reasons for that. Let us first concentrate on this graph on the left-hand side. And this is a publication by Stremmel et al., who's done probably the maximum work in patients with Wilson's disease and has shown that these patients with Wilson's, if treated adequately, have a normal lifespan. At this point, when they have normal lifespan, it becomes very important for us to understand the other manifestations of the disease which grossly affect the quality of life of these patients. So why this study here in CMC Vellore? Well, Wilson's is an autosomal recessive disorder known to occur more in communities with consanguinity, and unfortunately, Tamil Nadu ranks number one on the world map with respect to consanguineous marriages. I had three main objectives in the study. First was to study the prevalence of renal tubular acidosis in patients with Wilson's, also to look at the bone health and the body composition in these patients. I studied renal tubular acidosis by an extensive protocol published in the Endocrine Clinics of North America. We admitted these patients, did ammonium chloride loading test, a whole lot of electrolytes in the blood, urine, and diagnosed which type of RTA these patients had. I studied all patients more than 12 years, generously contributed by the Department of Hepatology and Neurology. I calculated a sample size of around 27 based on very meager data available on this aspect, got us through the IRB, screened a total of 28 patients in 1 year of Wilson's disease. However, I had to exclude 3 patients who were not fit to undergo evaluation for RTA, and found a total of 25 patients over a period of 1 year with a mean age of 20 years, most of them being men and a lot of them from Tamil Nadu. And surprisingly, what I found was that 14 out of 25 patients had RTA. That's more than 50% of the patients have renal tubular acidosis. Another 56% have low BMD, and a whole lot of them have a high body fat, low lean mass, and abnormal body metabolic composition, predisposing them for metabolic complications in future. So with the study, I concluded that renal tubular acidosis, low body mass, low body composition, and a low BMD is very common in patients with Wilson's disease. We should screen these complications early and treat these patients so that their quality of life can be improved. However, no study is without any limitations. The only limitation I had was low sample size, and we should qualify this data and into a larger numbers before we can formulate any guidelines for these common manifestations of this rare disease in patients who live normally. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Dr. Abhimanesh.
Hello, I'm Abhimanesh from Department of Medicine. My guide is Dr. Anand Zakaria from Medicine. Do you know that the suicide rates in Kanyambadi block, which is about 15 kilometers from where I stand, is actually 5 times greater than that of global average? Poisonous plants are important modes of suicide in this locality. Clystanthus coleus, or commonly Oduvanthalai, is one such. It's a poisonous shrub. The whole plant is poisonous, so much so that each one of 4 patients who take Oduvanthalai poisoning actually die. How do they die? They die because they drop their blood pressure, or they develop renal failure, or they die of breathing difficulty. The traditional management we have for patients with Oduvanthalai poisoning in this hospital is to replace potassium and bicarbonate salts as they are lost in their urine, and also to introduce a device called temporary pacemaker to make sure their heartbeats are okay because of serious arrhythmias that has been recorded in these patients. And also, we also realized as we manage patients, once they develop this hypotension or shock, there is no way of bringing them back, even with the best supportive ICU care. So we studied the mechanism of shock in these patients, all 20 patients who presented with odontalgic poisoning in the last 2 years to us. And we did this by measuring how well is the heart contracting, by doing echocardiographic studies, and also is there any irregular rhythm or arrhythmia by looking into continuous Holter data. And of these 20 patients, 3 people developed hypotension, and we showed that actually their heart contractility was normal by echocardiography and their rhythm recording did not show any arrhythmia. However, on examination, they had markedly warm peripheries and also systemic vascular resistance, which is an index of how good is your peripheral blood vessels contracting, is markedly low, even when these people were on multiple inotropes. So we concluded that probably the mechanism of shock in odontalgic poisoning is via inappropriate vasodilatation happening at the peripheral vasculature. And also, we collected more than 850 hours of Holter data in all these patients, and we did not record any arrhythmia. My study has potential clinical implications. We propose that the predominant mechanism of shock in odontalgic poisoning is not at the heart or at the rhythm, but actually it lies at the peripheral vascular tree via inappropriate vasodilatation. Hence, therapy should be targeted at preventing and treating this. And unlike previously believed, arrhythmias may not be the dominant mechanism of shock, and temporary pacemakers should be avoided except patients have symptomatic bradyarrhythmia. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ajay Abraham, hematologist.
I am Ajay Abraham from Hematology Department. My PhD guide is Dr. Pumkirli Balasubramaniam, and I am going to present my PhD thesis. There exists wide variation in terms of treatment outcome and toxic side effects of treatment among AML patients on chemotherapy with cytarabine and daunorubicin. This wide variation is the rationale for my PhD thesis, Mechanism of Cytarabine Resistance in Acute Myeloid Leukemia. My PhD work mainly revolves around this particular pathway, which is the nucleoside salvage pathway in the nucleoside biosynthesis. Since cytarabine is a nucleoside analog of cytidine, it undergoes the same metabolic activation. Briefly, cytarabine is given as continuous infusion. It reaches the cell surface and is taken inside by the transporter ENT1. It is then acted upon by a set of kinases, of which DCK or deoxycytidine kinase is the major kinase involved. It phosphorylates arachidonic to its active triphosphorylated form arachidonic, which incorporates into DNA and brings about the cell kill. There are certain deaminases and dephosphorylases which deactivate the drug. Cytidine deaminase is the major deaminase involved. Of the total 250 patients enrolled in the study, we evaluated the mRNA expression profile of all these arachidonic metabolic pathway genes, also the candidate drug resistant genes like ABC transporters. And we also did an in vivo cytotoxicity assay with cytarabine and classified the patients into sensitive, intermediate, and resistant group. It was found that DCK and ENT1 expression to be significantly higher in the sensitive group, and CDA expression was found to be significantly higher in the resistant group. Based on this observation, we formulated an index, ARASI resistance index, and we evaluated this index in 2 patients, one sensitive and one resistant. It was found that ARASI sensitive patient to have a lower RA value, and we extrapolated this in our whole cohort, and ARASI sensitive group were found to have a significantly low median RA when compared to the resistant group. Interestingly, relapsed patients at presentation had a higher RA value when compared to the sensitive group. We did the RA evaluation in our treated cohort also, and it was found that though the numbers were low, low RA patients were found to have a better disease-free survival. To find out additional contributors of ARASI resistance, we did a microarray analysis, and it was found that anti-apoptotic genes and the genes involved in cellular metabolism, especially the Warburg genes, were found to be overexpressed in ARASI resistant group. To conclude, our comprehensive index RA is shown to be significantly associated with in vivo as well as ex vivo cytotoxicity. And our microarray data proposed the possibility of using metabolic inhibitors as well as anti-apoptotic inhibitors in combination or in alone with ARASI to overcome drug resistance. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Rajat from the Department of General Surgery. My thesis guide was Dr. Mark Ranjan Jesudas. Condition seen in our outpatients is treated with radiation therapy followed by surgery. Surgery previously meant a permanent stoma and the entire stigma that went with it for almost all patients, except for a lucky few who had high rectal cancers. But over the years, as technology improved, surgical staples have come in, and our knowledge of rectal anatomy has improved, we are able to give more and more patients intestinal continuity, a low anterior resection. As a postgraduate registrar, I would see patients who had had a low anterior resection. They'd had the surgery, no stoma, usually were disease-free, no reason to complain, or so I thought. But usually, they would be incontinent to stool, having to go to the bathroom multiple times, thus a miserable quality of life. This was described in literature as a low anterior resection syndrome. Usually, this is because of the removal of the rectum by the surgery and damage to the anal sphincters by surgery, and also as new evidence suggested by radiation therapy. Could this damage to the anal sphincters be assessed and furthermore predicted so that even before surgery, the patient might know his quality of life many months down the line? With the consent of 28 patients of locally advanced rectal cancer, I measured resting and anal pressure and squeeze pressure using a modified anal manometer. I also measured continence scores, Wexner and CAM, which are standardized continence scores used all over the world. This gave me both an objective and a subjective or quasi-subjective assessment of the anal sphincter. These patients then had radiation therapy followed by a 6-week interval followed by surgery. Just before surgery, these measurements were repeated and we were able to calculate the difference and to see whether any correlation between the non-invasive questionnaire and the invasive anal manometry. What I did find was a significant decrease in both resting and squeeze pressures, and also a significant increase in the continence scores, meaning the patient was getting more and more incontinent as the time went by. Also, there was a significant correlation between the resting pressures and the CAM incontinence scores. Thus, I proved through my thesis that anal sphincter is adversely affected by radiation therapy, and then incontinence scores can be used as a surrogate marker of anal sphincter damage. With this knowledge, I further plan to study whether these patients actually develop anterior resection syndrome, and whether, if it could be predicted, would a patient choose a stoma over intestinal continuity over a poorer quality of life? Thus, the decision to give patient intestinal continuity or a permanent stoma after rectal resection would not be based only on oncology or the surgical dexterity, but also on the extent of sphincter damage and the patient's future quality of life. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nisha.
Good morning, I'm Dr. Nisha from the Department of Medicine. My guide was Dr. Samuel Hansteck. My thesis was on metabolic syndrome and CIMT. Metabolic syndrome, as defined by the IDF criteria, is a combination of raised blood sugars, increase in blood pressure, low HDL, and increase in triglyceride, along with an increase in waist circumference. This syndrome was first described more than 80 years ago, and it was initially described in order to identify people who were at higher risk of developing atherosclerosis. Since that time, medicine has evolved. We have so many newer methods for measuring atherosclerosis. One of these newer methods is the CIMT, keratin intima media thickness. What it does is it measures the thickness of the keratin and uses it as an early marker of atherosclerosis. As atherosclerosis progresses, usually the lumen of the keratin becomes obstructed, and then there is a hemodynamic disturbance in that there is a decrease in blood flow. So what this test does is that it picks up this atherosclerosis even before a plaque or even before an obstruction to the lumen of the vessel has developed. So it's a very good early marker of atherosclerosis. Knowing that there are so many newer methods of atherosclerosis measurement, what is the relevance of metabolic syndrome today? Is it still relevant? Does it pick up atherosclerosis early? So these were the questions that my study was aimed at answering. In order to do this, we did an observational study from the departments of medicine and cardiology. We recruited people from both the outpatient departments, about 116 people in all. The only inclusion criteria was the age. It was between the ages of 45 and 65. There was only one exclusion criteria, that is, they should not have already developed sequelae of atherosclerosis. They should not have had a heart attack. They should not have had a stroke in the past, because this means that the patient already has full-blown atherosclerosis, and we were looking to pick up atherosclerosis early. So once we recruited these people, we checked their CIMT, which is just an ultrasound study of the neck. We also check them for all the traditional risk factors for atherosclerosis. That is, we check them for diabetes, we check them for hypertension, we did their lipid profile, and we also check their waist circumference. Based on this, we divided them into two groups. Did they have metabolic syndrome or did they not have metabolic syndrome? And then we analyzed the results. What we saw was that among all our participants, only two factors, that is age and metabolic syndrome, were significantly associated with a positive CIMT. That means that only age and metabolic syndrome were able to predict early atherosclerosis. There were no other risk factors and no other permutation or combination of risk factors. You can combine diabetes and waist circumference, you can combine hypertension and various combinations of lipid profile. None of these were significantly associated with early atherosclerosis. That means to predict early atherosclerosis, if you just check a patient for the metabolic syndrome, you may be on the right path. The conclusion of the study is that metabolic syndrome is still relevant in today's world. That leaves us with only two choices. One, get the waist down, choose a healthy lifestyle, or end up 6 feet under. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mazda Turel from the Department of Neurological Sciences. And my thesis guide is Dr. Vedantam Rajshekhar. Brain edema is a common problem in neurosurgical procedures and a common cause of morbidity and mortality in neurosurgical practice. The commonly used drugs today, mannitol and steroids, have their side effects and their limitations. So we wanted to see if we could find a novel molecule which could affect the final common pathway and address all kinds of brain edema due to various causes. And hence, we decided on a novel tyrosine kinase inhibitor called PP1, which affects the final common pathway, reduces VEGF, and hence reduces brain edema as shown in the first flowchart. We obviously could not test this on humans straight away, so we decided to use mice. We took them into two groups, experimental and control groups, 20 mice. We fixed them on a stereotactic frame, and then we did a craniotomy on them with a dental drill, and then we used a cold injury model with a copper cylinder using dry ice and acetone and created an injury. However, initially we used the injury with our hands, but what was happening is that there was a large standard deviation in the results, and hence we designed an in-house automated cryo injury model which would impact the injury, transfer the force at a constant level, which is shown in the graph over here, for an exact time of 3 minutes, and once the copper cylinder is lifted off, there is no further injury. And this was transmitted through a force transducer signal amplifier and could be recorded on a computer screen, and this was designed by us in CMC. After the injury, the mouse was kept alive for 24 hours, following which we did a detailed neurological assessment, as you can see over here in the bottom panel, and assessed a neurological severity score of these mice, because we hit them on the motor cortex and they would have some degree of hemiplegia. Then what we did is we sacrificed the mice and removed the brains and measured the wet weight and the dry weight after incubating them in a hot air oven, and then calculated the brain edema. In the group that got the drug, there was a reduction in the brain edema and the neurological injury score was much less. But however, due to our small numbers, this was not statistically significant. What it does, it opens up excellent insights into what the pathology and the molecular mechanisms of brain edema are, and how we can have targeted molecular therapy in the future when we use larger number of experimental animals. But more interestingly, what it did is we designed an automated cryo injury model, which is being now used for successive studies on brain injury. Thank you very much.
Good morning, I'm Tarun K. George from the Department of Medicine. My guides for my thesis were Dr. Soumya, Dr. J.V. Peter, and Dr. David Chase. While we're waiting, I wanted to say that if we thought getting a thesis was difficult, trying to compress it into 3 minutes was quite a challenge in itself. I remember when I was working in a rural hospital, we had a young boy who had come to us with severe breathlessness and palpitations. He had just consumed a very toxic compound. We admitted him in our little ICU, and we weren't really sure what would happen to him. But 2 days later, he died of a heart attack, a cardiac arrest. When I joined here as a PG, I realized that we were still seeing similar problems. We were having patients coming into the casualty and the emergency department with varying illnesses, often not knowing exactly what's going on. We would then shift them into the ICU and try to predict to the family whether they would make it or not. At this stage, we knew that we did have scores like the Apache score and the SOFA score, which would tell us that this may or may not happen. But they weren't always very accurate. When patients come, they are young, old, they have poisonings, sicknesses, multiple organ involvements. But one thing is often the terminal event can be cardiac. So we decided to go back to the start, at admission, to get to the heart of the matter. We decided, let's look at the cardiac event. Now, the electrical activity of the heart is conducted and translated into a mechanical action. Now, we can capture this electrical activity on an electrocardiogram, or the ECG. And the waves of the ECG, as you see, represent the function of the different chambers. The Q, R, S, and the T wave, together the QT interval, translates into the function of the ventricle, which is involved in pumping the blood out of the heart to the rest of the body. So if you have a prolonged QT interval, it means that there's abnormality in the functioning of the heart and a functioning from the electrical to the mechanical component of the heart. So what I did was, we decided, let's look at the heart, let's look at them at admission, the QT intervals. Let's look at the risk factors for these QT intervals during the course of ICU stay, and what are the outcomes. What I found was, a third of these patients who were admitted into the ICU had a prolonged QT interval. A third of them were actually given drugs unknowingly that could further prolong the QT interval. And on the third day, on following them up again, a third of them had a resolution of that QT interval. I also noted that when we looked at the outcomes of these patients at the ICU stay, the risk of the patients who had a QT interval for a fatal outcome was almost doubled. Now, these are very significant findings, and we do need to validate them much further. But what this tells us is, a simple ECG, whether in a rural hospital or a tertiary center, can go a long way in deciding whether you take care of the patient a little closer, deciding on the drugs you're given, and God willing, maybe even the start of a more effective scoring system. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Anu George from dermatology. For this 3-minute thesis competition, we'll just start with a word of prayer. Lord, we commit this
today, Dr. A.M. Cherian. We're very fortunate to have you here, sir. Dr. L. Jaisilan and Dr. Abraham Padikail. So just a few words before we actually start about the 3-minute presentation thesis is that I would like to give you a brief idea about how this actually was started here. So this is actually it originated only in the University of Queensland, where the main idea was to see how the researchers are able to explain their research in very limited time. So this was adopted into many universities all over the world, and it happens yearly. It's going to be held every year from now onwards. So the three judging panel for the today's competition is going to be Dr. A.M. Cherian. Dr. A.M. Cherian is the founder of CEU, Clinical Epidemiology Unit in our institution. He was the former head of the department for the Department of Medicine, and he was also a professor right now in the Bangalore Baptist Hospital. Sir was the one who actually initiated a lot of inland projects into our institution here. And he was actually responsible, who also brought into some from departments like endocrine, rheumatology. So, sir, we are very fortunate to have you here, sir. It's good to have you here. And we warmly welcome you, sir. Thanks for accepting our invitation. The next judge is Dr. L. Jaisilan. He was the former head of the Department of Biostatistics, and he is also the founder of Biostatistics Research and Training Center. I'm sure most of you already know him because he is the one who deals with a lot of sample size and
thank you. Dr. Amit from Cardio.
Good morning, everybody. I am Dr. Amit from Department of Cardiology. My thesis guide was Professor Jacob Jones. Every year, 3 million people suffer from heart attack in our country, and more than 30 would have lost their life by the end of this presentation. So as a cardiologist, I felt strongly to do something for this. That's how I chose my thesis topic. I intended to study one of the most important and neglected complication of heart attack, that is mitral regurgitation. It simply means the blood flow in the reverse direction in the heart. Mitral regurgitation is often overlooked, underrated, and clinically undetectable complication of heart attack. And the data about the same is lacking in our population. It often proves to be a silent killer in the patients of heart attack. My research primarily focuses on the prevalence and accurate assessment of this important complication of heart attack patients. This is the first Indian data to look at this important complication of heart attack, and what we found was astonishing. We found a significant number, approximately 23% of the patients presenting with heart attack had this important complication. And moreover, this was much more significant in patients who were elderly and diabetics. And my thesis also emphasizes the importance of regularly following these patients because many patients have developed MR in the due course of time during the follow-up only. The most rewarding part of my thesis was if we can diagnose these patients in time, we can treat them aggressively better than the other patients and we can save millions of lives. I wish to spread more and more awareness about this complication, and I wish I can stop pain in the heart and tears in the eyes in the future. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Hello, I'm Dr. Ajay Kumar Mishra from General Medicine. My thesis guide is Dr. Tambut. Cerebrovascular accident, also called a stroke, gets its name from the ancient belief that these people actually got struck by the hand of God. We know that cerebrovascular accident or stroke occurs due to a decrease in blood supply to a part of brain, and it is the third most common cause of death worldwide. Every 2 seconds, one person is affected of stroke, and in different patients, the presentation and the prognosis is variable following stroke. We wanted to find out what is the outcome following stroke in South India. I specifically asked what happens to mortality in patients who come to CMC Vellore at the end of 1 month, 6 months, and 12 months. In the year of 2012, 47,500 people came to CMC emergency department. Of them, 490 had cerebral vascular accident. Because 437 were from in and around Vellore, they were recruited into my study. As the bar diagram on the left side shows, as we followed them at the end of 1 month, 6 months, and 12 months, we found that almost 25% of the mortality was there at the end of 1 month. Now we looked at the cause of this mortality in hospital patient. Surprisingly, we found that 50% of the death were because of the severity of the stroke itself. However, the remaining were reversible. When we tried to look at the reversible causes, we found that half of the reversible causes were because of aspiration pneumonia. People with stroke are not able to protect their airway and they have a poor cough reflex. Now, that is why they are more prone to aspirate food. Now this is what causes the complication of aspiration pneumonia. Now, what my study highlights is that the death following stroke is most common following in the 1 month of stroke. And if we can manage aspiration pneumonia, predict and prevent, that will help a lot in outcome of stroke. Thank you.
Thank you. I think some people took 3 minutes too seriously and finished in 1 minute. But I want to thank all the presenters. What we have next is, I want to invite our chief guest, Dr. Joy, to give us a few words. I would ask all of you to just wait for 3 minutes, as the thesis time suggests. We will announce the winners, and then we will have the end of our function. So I want to thank Dr. Joy for coming in the, as our chief guest. And she is representing the principal, who is the head of our clinical epidemiology unit. Dr. Joy.
Good morning, and I'm really happy to be representing the principal today. And at the outset, I'd like to really congratulate Dr. Tambu, David, the head of Clinical Epidemiology Unit, for bringing this exciting new opportunity for our faculty. And I hope that next year we see more PGs getting involved, because in this way it really improves your speaking skills, able to concise your idea. I think most of us are really happy to talk for a long time on your thesis, but this is really challenging, and it really improves your ability to convey all what you want to do and what you have done in your thesis. And also I'd like to thank our judges. I'd really like to welcome back Dr. A.M. Charyan, former professor and head of medicine, and the chief of medicine, who actually conceptualized the CU. And welcome, sir, and thank you for coming. I'd like to thank Dr. Jay Seelan and Dr. Ibrahim Pedikal for also being with us and helping us with this judging. I'd also like to congratulate every one of you who took part. It is really nice to see how enthusiastic all of you are. I don't know how we will do as senior faculty. Congratulations, and it's really wonderful talent that we have. And I think just going through the website, I was really excited how I think you can also match up to the standards, what's happening in Australia and different parts of the country and in the world. I think we can also challenge them, and many of you did really wonderfully well. And congratulate Dr. Tambu again, and thanks for this wonderful program. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Joy. I'd like to ask the judges to just give a few words, their comments on the program before we announce the winners. I'll start with Dr. Charyan.
First of all, let me thank you, Tambu, and rest of the CU and department of various departments involved for inviting me to come and be a judge. And this is really a good idea to encourage young people to do research and present, and give a prize also for that. And I hope more such activities will come through to the down PG students as well for the best dissertation or some things like that to encourage research in CMC. Research in CMC, I must say, from looking from outside, we lag behind quite a lot. I talked to Dr. Sunil Chandy about this once. We do a lot of small research, but not any new drug for diabetes or a big epoch-making research we are not involved at all. When we have the best facility in the country to do research, we have the best supporting departments, biochemistry, clinical pathology, anatomy, physiology, you take any department, biochemistry, biostatistics, such a wonderful set of support staff which we are not making use of. And I'm sure in the years to come with people like Ipan and all in the hem of things should encourage people, more people to get interested in big research, like big research departments, like CU is one of them, and at least under the guidance of CU, where we initially envisage we'll get research ideas, biostatistics help, write up work and after publication. So all this help is available in CMC, which other medical colleges, as far as I know, is not there. And the labs are not dependable. We have such good labs to go by. And money is not a problem. For small research grants are available in the form of fluid research grants, institutional grants. And we have big fellows who can attract grants from outside. But we really are so busy with the clinical work, I agree. But that's why the idea of pure research departments, if we can come, who carry along with the help of other departments, research and big publication, we can have another CMC just doing research alone. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Jaisil, Dr. Abhi.
Again, congratulate all the presenters. I thought it was very good. I was encouraged by the amount of talent that there is in our institution, and really keep it up. And I think every department should encourage and, if possible, give protected time. I know that is something that admin has to work on, but if a department can give, you know, a protected time in terms of maybe 1 or 2 days a week or 1 week a month, then the junior people will produce a lot of research.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Jaisil.
Thanks, Tambu, for this opportunity. I'm very happy to sit close to Dr. A.M. Cherian, who is the father of clinical epidemiology in CMC. Nice to see him. I was overwhelmed by the dissertations from the surgical department. I have been helping urology and surgery departments on clinical trials, which is a very big change in the last 3 years. This is a big change. This is a change towards a high quality research, which is happening in CMC now. As Dr. Cherian said, that I agree with him that we need to work very hard to push or towards a high quality, big level research in CMC.
Thank you, sir. We are in 1 more minute. We'll announce the results. Dr. C. Eppan will be giving away the prizes. Before that, I'll ask him to just say a few words.
Thank you, Tambu. It's all instant. I had a 1 minute notice there. You're all getting used to instant coffee, fast food, and 3 minute thesis. It's a bit overwhelming. I think if you open it out, surely you need a larger hall and more time for this event. But the fact that there is enough people standing outside and people coming in and going out without space indicates it's surely a popular event, and we should plan for it better. So we'll take your suggestion seriously and see how we can earmark more resources in terms of everything which CMC provides. Surely our mandate is for excellence in all that we do, and what we have in addition to all that you mentioned is the ethical framework which all of us enjoy working here with. So I'm sure that aspect of research is something which we can surely contribute to. Tabu, my 1 minute is over.
Thank you, sir. The results, just give us 15 seconds more. Just checking if the numbers are correct before we announce the results. Is there anybody from the audience would like to make any comment? Or I think we should give a hand to the presenters one more time. I must not fail to mention that actually when I mentioned this to Dr. Eppan, we said that we should keep this to the junior medical board, of which Dr. Pawamani is in charge, so he has helped us to spread the message to the junior medical board. So the first time we have kept the presentation only to people who are assistant professors, post-MD and post-PhD. Maybe next time we'll have it, as Dr. Joy said, for PG students when they finish submitted their dissertation. And then we can open it out to other people. So we just thought we'll try it out for this first time and see how it goes. And then we'll take it from there. More than 3 minutes. We'll go in reverse order. We are again thankful to the principal who has allowed us to give this cash prize for the thesis presentations. The third prize goes to Dr. Elizabeth. I asked Dr. Epen to come forward and give the prizes. The third prize is Dr. Elizabeth Vinod from the Department of Physiology. Congratulations, Elizabeth. The second prize goes to Dr. Ajay Abraham from Hematology. And the first prize, any guesses from the audience? Is Dr. Prakash SS from the Department of Biochemistry. Before I end, I just want to say thank you to Dr. Epen, thank you to Dr. Cherian, Dr. Jaisilan, and Dr. Abraham. I want to especially thank Alphonse, who has really helped arrange the whole thing, and the people from Audiovisual. We will be putting up this video of the entire presentation on the YouTube, as well as on the three-minute thesis competition website, so we can see the entire presentation. Thank you all for coming. I wish you all a nice day. Thank you.